since failure is not an option, we need to figure out what to do next. And we will try to do this by learning a little bit of biology. And biology will give us a hint on how we should implement our algorithms. Some of you may find description of somewhat convoluted biological concepts that I am about to present difficult to digest. If you feel like this, don't worry. If you believe me that DNA replication is an asymmetric process, then you can simply skip this part and go to the point when we derive from this biological knowledge how to design efficient algorithms. So the first thing to remind ourselves is that DNA strands have directions. And the two strands of DNA run in opposite direction. Here on this slide, the blue strand runs clockwise and the green strand runs counterclockwise. And if you were a DNA polymerase, how would you replicate a genome? If I was a DNA polymerase, I would do something very simple. I would wait until DNA unwind a little bit, recruit 4 DNA polymerases, and we'll just move them along the genome trying to replicate it. It looks like just 4 DNA polymerases are enough to replicate the whole genome. And when replication fork enlarge, I continue and continue my replication process. This is simple, but completely wrong. And if there are biology professors attending this lecture, they are probably already writing a petition to fire me and send me to biology 101 camp. The reason why it doesn't work is that DNA polymerases are unidirectional. They can only copy DNA in the direction that is opposite to the direction of DNA. Which means that when we want to recruit 4 polymerases to replicate DNA, 2 of them, this one and this one, will be working just fine. But 2 others won't be able to move because they cannot move in the same direction as the direction of DNA. Then we can classify DNA strands into 4 half strands. The strands that I showed you, the blue strands that goes from origin to terminus, is the reverse half strand. And I have no problem replicating it because moving from origin to terminus goes in the opposite direction to DNA. Likewise, this thick green line that I show right now is also doesn't present any problem replicating. 1 DNA polymerase can accomplish it. But 2 other half strands present big, big problem because they cannot move in the same direction that they go. So if you were a unidirectional DNA polymerase, how would you replicate a genome? Here's a potential solution. Wait until fork enlarges. And when it enlarges, start replicating it in the opposite, in the same direction as DNA. Then fork enlarges a little bit more, you put another DNA polymerase and continue replicating. 4 DNA polymerases won't be enough because each of these DNA polymerases that I recruited copied just approximately 3,000 nucleotides. So you may need a huge number of DNA polymerases to proceed this way. You can see that the resulting fragments, these many fragments that are being built called OKAZAKI fragments, complicate our life a little bit. But in the end, after this process is over, we will have many OKAZAKI fragments, so we will have genome copied in many, many little fragments. And the only thing we need afterwards is just to repair the gaps between different OKAZAKI fragments and to replicate the genome. So the only thing we need to learn about this process to proceed with our algorithm afterwards is that reverse and forward half strands, so thick half strands and thin half strands, have very different lifetime. The reverse half strands lives a double-stranded life because it's constantly replicated. There is hardly a moment when it lives double-stranded. But the forward half-strands spend a large portion of its life single-stranded because it has to wait until replication forks open until it starts replication. I hope this is clear, but there is one looming question. Why would a computer scientist care? And we will learn in the next segment why computer scientists should care about this. So, asymmetry of replication affects nucleotide frequencies. Why? Let's think about this. Single-stranded DNA has a much higher mutation rate than double-stranded DNA. That's why if one nucleotide has a greater mutation rate, then we should observe a shortage of this nucleotide on the forward half strand because it spans single-stranded life. Which nucleotide, A, T, C, or G, has the higher mutation rate, and why? It turned out that there is a peculiar statistics of mutation rates of nucleotides, and cytosine, C, rapidly mutates into T. What is quite amazing is that through this deamidation process, rate of mutation rise 100-fold when DNA is single-stranded, which means that the strands that live single-stranded life very quickly get depleted from C. What does it mean for us as algorithm designers? Forward half strands that live single-stranded life has shortage of C and normal G. Reverse half strands that live double-stranded life have shortage of G and normal C. Now, keeping this in mind, let's take a walk along the genome. We start at terminus, and let's say we move from terminus according to the red line to origin. In this case, we move along the strand at which there is C is high and G is low, which means that G minus C is decreasing as we walk, right? But when we walk along this half strand, on this half strand, C is low and G is high, which means G minus C, total number of nucleotide G minus total number of nucleotide C, is increasing as we walk. Again, this sounds like peculiar and not very important thing. Why do we care? I ask one more question. If you walk along a genome and you see and you count number of G and number of C that you, minus number of C that you saw, and you have seen that number of G minus number of C have been decreasing and then suddenly start increasing. Imagine, just imagine, you walk through the genome, you count the difference, G minus C, and it has been decreasing and then suddenly start increasing. My question is, where in the genome are you? And to figure out where in the genome we need once again to look at peculiar statistics. The only place in the genome where behavior of G minus C switches from decreasing to increasing is origin of replication. Which means that if you walk along the genome and see that G minus C has been decreasing and then suddenly start increasing, it means you just passed the origin of replication. And this is a hint for our algorithm.